So myelin is mixed neuroendocrine, non-neuroendocrine neoplasm, and to call something myelin, a third of it needs to be neuroendocrine, and at least a third non-neuroendocrine, either adenocarcinoma or squamous cell carcinoma. That's it. There are exceptions to every rule, and the exception here is that the neuroendocrine carcinoma component can be less than a third, and I am deadly serious about this. Let's take a look at this periampullary tumor. So here's a very low power view. That stuff there and there looks like a villous adenoma, doesn't it? But how about this stuff at the base? Look at those angulated glands. That's invasive adenocarcinoma. And then, what's this doing in the center? That looks very, very different. That's definitely adenocarcinoma. But that component there looks very high grade. Now, granted, there's some sort of glandular pattern of differentiation, but doesn't that look neuroendocrine? That looks neuroendocrine carcinoma. Look at those monotonous nuclei. Look at that chromatin, and look at that necrosis in the center. And if you don't believe me, there's the positive chromogranin stain. The glandular component is negative. As you can see, the Ki-67 labeling index is nearly 100% in the neuroendocrine carcinoma component, but it is also positive in the adenocarcinoma component. What do you call this? 80% adenocarcinoma, 20% neuroendocrine carcinoma. Would you ignore the rules and call this myelin? Don't tell me there's no rebel left in you. So what did I do? I did call it a myelin. Why? Because this is going to behave like a myelin. It's going to behave like a neuroendocrine carcinoma. In fact, the lymph node met was a neuroendocrine carcinoma. Now, if you do not want to call this a myelin, I would describe the two components, but your clinician will most likely treat the neuroendocrine carcinoma component. So there are rules, but if you break them, things will still be okay.